Hi everybody. In this video, we're going to actually solve the Schrödinger equation for the particle in a one-dimensional box, which we introduced in the previous video. First, I'd like to just remind us of where we left off. In the previous video, we defined a particle in a one-dimensional box as a situation in which the potential energy operator is equal to zero inside the box and is equal to infinity outside the box. And without really getting into all of the math, we talked about some of our expectations of how a quantum mechanical object would behave in this sort of environment. First of all, we said that the wave function has to have a value of zero outside the box. Otherwise, the potential energy of the object would be infinite, which isn't possible. Also, we said that inside the box, the wave function has to behave as if it's in free space. In other words, the wave function has to be oscillating. It has to be a sine or a cosine or a complex exponential or some combination of those. And finally, because quantum mechanical wave functions have to be continuous, these different segments of the wave function have to meet each other at the edges of the box. In other words, if the wave function has to be equal to zero outside the box, the wave function inside the box has to reach zero at the edges. So let's define our one-dimensional box as existing from x equals 0 to x equals some length L. We know that the wave function is equal to 0 outside the box. And what we're trying to figure out is what do the wave functions look like inside the box. As we showed in the previous video, energy eigenfunctions that have energy h bar squared k squared over 2m can be expressed in the following form. A sum of complex exponentials e to the ikx and e to the negative ikx. Alternatively, we can express these same energy eigenfunctions as a sum of sines and cosines, sine kx and cosine kx. These two forms are actually completely equivalent. Euler's formula allows us to express complex exponentials as sines and cosines, or vice versa. Which form we use is really a matter of convenience. And in this case, for a particle in a box, it turns out sines and cosines will be more convenient. So, our wave functions inside the box have the following form. Some constant c times sine of kx plus some other constant d times cosine of kx. Notice that these wave functions have three unknowns, c, d, and k. So really, what we're trying to do here is solve for those three unknowns. We have a few pieces of information that allow us to do this. First of all, we know that the value of the wave function has to be zero at the edges of the box. Because the wave function is zero outside the box and it has to be continuous, that means the wave function at the edges, x equals zero and x equals L, has to be zero. These sorts of statements are called boundary conditions, and we'll see them throughout quantum mechanics. And the other piece of information we can use is the fact that this wave function will be normalized. It turns out that with these boundary and normalization conditions, we can completely figure out the values of C, D, and K. Let's first look at the requirement that the wave function has to be equal to zero at x equals zero, the left side of the box. If we plug x equals zero into the wave function, we find that the wave function at x equals zero equals c sine 0 plus d cosine 0. Hopefully you remember that the sine of 0 equals 0 and the cosine of 0 equals 1, which means that this expression is equal to d, and as we know from the boundary condition, also has to be equal to 0. So we find that the constant d has to be equal to 0, which simplifies our wave function a lot. It means that the cosine term goes away completely, and the wave function has to be equal to a constant c times the sine of kx. Let's look next at the other boundary condition, the requirement that the wave function is 0 at x equals L, the right side of the box. If we plug in x equals L, we find that c times the sine of kl has to be equal to 0. C, which is basically a normalization constant, is not going to be equal to 0. So we know that the sine of kl has to equal 0. One possibility is that k itself equals 0, but that's not a very interesting possibility. It just means that there's no particle there, and the wave function can't be normalized. But keep in mind that it's not just the sine of 0 that equals 0. It's also the sine of pi, and the sine of 2 pi, and the sine of 3 pi, etc. So what this equation is telling us is that k times l has to be some integer number times pi. We'll call it n pi, where n equals 1, 2, 3, etc. And if we rearrange this equation, we find that k has to be equal to n pi over l. This is a really important result. It tells us that for a particle in a box, only specific values of k are allowed. This means the wave functions, and also their energies, are quantized. This is really the first case where we've solved the Schrödinger equation and seen that the quantization of energy is a natural consequence of it. And finally, let's look at our third constraint, the fact that our wave functions have to be normalized. As we've seen, when a wave function is normalized, it means the integral of that wave function times its complex conjugate equals 1. In this case, we only have to worry about our wave functions inside the box, because we know they're equal to 0 outside the box. If we plug in our particle in a box wave functions, we can take c squared out of this integral because it's just a constant. And we're left with an integral that's difficult to take by hand, but is easy to look up in an integral table. We find that this normalization integral equals c squared times l over 2, which means that c equals the square root of 2 over l. So now we've completely solved for all the unknowns in our particle in a box wave functions, and we find that the wave functions are equal to the square root of 2 over l times the sine of n pi x over l for all positive integer values of n. Now that we've found the particle in a box wave functions, it's pretty straightforward to find their energies, recognizing that the measured energy will be the eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian operator. Inside the box where the potential energy operator equals 0, the Schrödinger equation looks like this. Negative h bar squared over 2m times the second derivative of the wave function equals the measured energy times the wave function. If we plug our particle in a box wave functions into this equation, we end up with this, which looks complicated, but we can then group the constants and find that we're left with h bar squared n squared pi squared over 2ml squared times the original wave function. So far in this course, we've usually been using h bar, which remember is equal to h over 2 pi. In this case, since we also have pi's in our equation, it's actually more convenient for us to use h. So we can write this as h squared n squared over 8ml squared times the original wave function. This means this grouping of constants out front is the energy that you would measure. It's the energy eigenvalue of the particle in a box wave functions. And just like the wave functions themselves, this means the energies are quantized. The energies that are possible for a particle in a box of length L are h squared n squared over 8ml squared for all positive integer values of n. So only certain energies are possible. For the last couple minutes of this video, let's summarize a few of the interesting things that we've found. First of all, we found that the allowed wave functions for a particle in a one-dimensional box are sine functions. And because the wave functions have to be zero outside the box and have to be continuous at the edges of the box, only certain wavelengths are allowed. You can see in this picture that shows the two lowest energy wave functions that each wave function has some number of half wavelengths in the box. N equals 1 has 1 half wavelength, N equals 2 has a full wavelength, N equals 3 has 1.5 wavelengths, etc. The Born interpretation of quantum mechanics tells us that the probability of finding an object at a given point is proportional to the wave function squared. If we plot the wave function squared, we end up with pictures that look like this. Wherever the wave function was very positive or very negative, we're most likely to find the particle. And wherever the wave function crosses zero, there's no chance that we'll find the particle there. We came across this idea earlier. Points where the wave function equals zero are called nodes. And as n increases, particle in a box wave functions have increasing numbers of nodes. Because we don't typically count the edges of the box as nodes, the n equals 1 wave function has 0 nodes, the n equals 2 wave function has 1 node, and in general, each wave function has n minus 1 nodes. Also, notice that these boundary conditions at the edges of the box cause the energies to be quantized. Energies can take on values n squared h squared over 8ml squared for every positive integer value of n. This means the energies are quantized and they're proportional to n squared. So as n gets larger, the energies get higher and farther apart. It's also interesting to notice that the lowest energy, the value you get when you plug in n equals 1, is not zero. So even in its lowest energy ground state, a particle in a box has some kinetic energy. In quantum mechanics, this idea is called zero-point energy, energy that an object has even at absolute zero temperature. Finally, I'd like to put the particle in a box model in the context of our everyday experience. I'd like you to think about this question. For what masses of particles and for what lengths of boxes is the quantization of energy most noticeable? In other words, based on the equations in this slide, for what values of m and what values of l are the quantized energy levels farthest apart? I'll give you a few seconds to think about that. The quantized energy levels are given by the last equation on this slide. The energy level corresponding to a value of n is equal to n squared h squared over 8ml squared, where the mass of the object is m and the length of the box is l. These energy levels are closer together when the denominator is large and farther apart when the denominator is small. That means for large macroscopic objects that exist in large spaces, the energy levels are so close together that we really don't notice the quantization of energy. That's why quantization of energy isn't really something that we see in our everyday experience. And it's why the scientific community was able to get away with just classical mechanics for hundreds of years. So for macroscopic objects, or even for atoms moving around in a container, or even for protons, the energy levels are really, really close together, to the point that we don't even notice the quantization of energy. But when the particles get even lighter and even smaller, I'm talking about electrons confined to atoms and molecules, then we start to notice the quantization of energy. Then the energy levels get farther apart. So that's kind of the big picture of why quantum mechanics applies mainly to electrons. Because only very small masses confined to very small lengths result in energy levels that are far enough apart to notice. And although the particle in a box model is kind of an idealized model, it does have some quantitative predictive value for real systems, particularly the pi electrons in conjugated molecules. A molecule like the one shown at the bottom of the screen is essentially a one-dimensional box for pi electrons to move around in. So it's possible to do a reasonable job predicting the energy differences of pi orbitals using just the particle in a box model. That's all for now. In the next video, we'll talk about a few more topics that extend this particle in a box model.